and gentlemen, I would like to announce that this is my very first appearance with Jensen on stage, and I'm super excited about it. Ty Olsson, everybody.
One more round of applause for Sebastian Brock, huh?
Yeah.
Seriously, it looked like there was a rave out here. What happened? This place was clean when I was here earlier.
I leave for 5 minutes, yeah. People, and this happens.
Hey, everybody. Everybody having a good Saturday? Ty, stop playing with the toys.
I'm in trouble already. All weekend. Ty, clock.
What the?
Hey, may I make a suggestion?
You want to open a box?
Everybody opens them at the end?
Yeah.
Suggest we open them like early.
What the? Hey, do you want to sit down? Let's sit. You dignified people.
I never sit.
But you never sit?
Yeah. It's going to get weird because I'll sit pieces.
It is going to get weird. It already is weird, to be honest.
Yep.
So, I got nothing. Everybody's having a good Saturday?
Yeah.
Everybody's awake still?
Yeah. Yes.
Hi, and just for 1 second.
Wait, if you want to open a box, let's open a box.
No, don't be open a box, but just...
This is how Ty and I work together.
This is how
you want to do this one? This way.
Rome
is walking around the car. This one.
Rome is in Jared.
Right.
Feel comfortable.
Jared Pat, like you, ladies and gentlemen.
We were talking about that earlier. What's the next thing from Jared?
Like this. Hey, how's the weather up there?
Does my nipple look safe to you? Cannon, can open a box if you wish.
You know what? Yeah, pick one out. You went with a pretty bow, didn't you? All right. I'm so happy that
Sebastian didn't get it.
Or Richard. It would have been a whole act. In fact, I'm going to keep this and give this to Richard because what am I supposed to do with this? Give it to Richard and let him come up with a full puppet? All right, that's helping. Well, we've only got a little limited amount of time, so we're going to start some questions. We'll start over with the gentleman over here.
He's got a friend in America who was earlier today.
Are you psychic? How do you know this? Don't answer that question.
I've been in every panel today.
This is true. You've been sitting in the back, like auditing every panel.
His German accent is really good, too. really good.
Is that
been a point in your performance? I felt like I'm not through with this, but not enough time to be better.
That's a loaded question.
Look, he's reading it off his phone. I wasn't kidding. He's reading it off his friend in America.
Yeah.
Performance, but it will have to do because of time. I'm so,
To answer your question, yes, that does happen. It's because, and Ty can attest to this as well, because television is such a rapid pace in production, we're filming at such a fast speed because you have to. Time is money, and the more time you take to get something done, I mean, there's a very, we're packing a lot of production into 8 days of schedule per episode. So a lot of times, you have to pick your battles with what you want to really focus on. So if there is an expedition, or help me out. Exposition scene, thank you, God. If there's an exposition scene where we're just literally trying to get information out to the audience and move on, you know, sometimes it's, you might just burn through the dialogue to get it out because you've got to get to the really important stuff.
I always say, too, one thing that you can't underestimate in this business is trusting your director and your editor. I've had scenes where I've left the scene going, we didn't get that. There's no way we got that. That's going to suck. And then you watch it, and you're like,
wow, we got that.
That was a really solid scene. I don't know how that happened. And conversely, I've done scenes where you leave it high-fiving each other, thinking, man, we nailed that.
We nailed that, and you see it, and it's like, how did that not come together?
So there's a little bit of that. Because it is such a time constraint, and obviously the budget constraints to everything you do. So yeah, have to.
But I will say that for our show anyway, I know that for the really important scenes or sequences or moments in the script, we do take our time with that, and we make sure that we get that and we feel good. Like, you know, Ty and I have had a few scenes where it's we had it. Like, it's like, okay, it's I got it. But let me go again because there might be something different. So now we're adding some extra stuff into the scene. Whereas if it was a scene where we're just giving out information, we might not do that. We might just kind of move on and get, you know. But we do take the time for the scenes that truly matter, and those are the scenes that people, you know, that's really pushing the story forward.
You know, let me tell you too. This is something that I have a little bit more experience than even Jensen does, because I've been a guest on a lot of shows. Jensen's been a fortunate guy to be working on his own show for a long time. Supernatural, and this is you and Jared and the crew of Supernatural, they're a well-oiled machine. It's phenomenal how well, how much they cover, what quality of product they get in such a short amount of time. And it's really because these guys all work together so tightly. And that's a lot of that is you and Jared as well.
Yeah, we move pretty quick because we know. I mean, at this point, it's like, listen, it's sink or swim, and if we're going to get this show done, then we gotta really be on the ball. And everybody, we have an amazing crew that just, I mean, you can throw weather at them, you can throw wind. I've had people in up in 80-foot lights, condors, the big cranes, and they're just like swaying back and forth, you know. And it's like, all right, get the guy down, we'll figure something else out, put some rain gear on, keep moving. So it's really like an army that just, you can't, nothing can sway them, and you have to. It's crazy. Thank you. Yeah. Hi.
Hi. Your cast for purgatory, how is it possible that you had all the
other stuff on that cast? You know what's really trippy? I kid you not. I'll tell you, I was just looking at you, because I never seen you in a beard. And I lived one. You should have had a beard in purgatory. It would look really cool on you. Seriously, I was just literally looking at him.
The problem was with that. I probably would have had this, but what happened is last year they let me direct an episode that I directed first. So we shot that episode first, but it was like the third episode of the season. So in the episode that I directed, which is what we shot first, Dean was already out of purgatory and had already shaved. And so we just had to go with it. And I like to think that Dean likes to shave with his knife.
Cool concept too.
The purgatory blade is just...
There's a cool concept in purgatory too, that, you know, one of the things is that they have hunger in purgatory, and so I think it's kind of cool, kind of time stops,
as well. Like, you don't age, you don't get hungry, you don't get thirsty, you don't grow facial hair.
True. You don't grow a beard. I think this probably, I love the purgatory stuff, and I think that if I could go back and maybe tweak one little thing, it might be the fact that these probably look a little more weathered and rough, and a little bit like he's been out in the wilderness for months and months. But, you know, it's television, and we just got to go and kind of roll with it.
Next question.
You know why, Misha? You might have to ask Misha that. He came back from hiatus with a beard, and I guess the producers were just like, yeah, sure, that works.
Thank you.
You know, yeah. Thank you. Hi.
Hello.
Sorry,
Ty. Just the gentleman.
I'll butt in anyways. Okay.
I love you still. Okay, so I was sad to see that Dean and Castiel were falling back to being at odds with each other and communicative. After Cass left with the Angel Tablet, especially after Dean admitted that he needs Cass, and that they were close that way. And so I was wondering, are we looking at a return to season 6 when Cass is working behind Dean and Sam's back, or are they going to find a way to work together and support each other like Dean has been supporting Sam?
Let me get Tyler on. Let me take this one. I just want to say, you know, it's funny because I'm listening to that question, but I get questions like, what's Jensen smell like? You get questions like, in season 6, episode 2, when Cass and you said that line and you gave him a little look, what did that look mean? He smells good.
You know the answer to that. You asked me that question 2 nights ago.
Leather and whiskey.
Yeah, you know, you'll see in the season finale, which has not aired yet, that there is, I don't want to say too much. there is a struggle with Cass and Dean as far as, their relationship, but I think much like Sam and Dean, there is an underlying kind of bond. There's friendship there that kind of supersedes whatever troubles are happening. They're always going to kind of, look out for one another, have each other's back, and they might have their own agenda sometimes, but you'll see in the season finale what old Cass is up to.
Awesome, thank you.
Yeah, thanks. Hi. Has some girls been inside Dean's room in the Men of Letters thing? Well, yeah. They're blindfolded. They can't. I can't let them know where the secret lair is. I have to blindfold them, bring them in. What? I don't know. Maybe Dean has other, there's always the back of the Impala, isn't there? Does he really need a bed?
It's like a bed back there anyways.
Pretty much, yeah. I mean, it's a boat. Well, I think Dean did get some action in the backseat, didn't he?
Yeah.
Funny you remember that.
So I don't think Dean's certain. I don't think he's needs to bring anybody back to the secret place. I think he can take care of the business elsewhere.
Like how you put that, take care of his business.
He can take care of his business.
It's a family business. But now it's a family business.
That's right. Yeah. That hunting thing, saving people, getting girls. You know, the family business. Yeah. All right. Hi.
Hi. My question's
for Jensen, sorry Ty.
You know Ty's gonna answer, didn't he? I kid, what's up?
I've spent the previous few days in Corinth, and I know that Daniil's previously said that it's one of your favourite places. And I was just wondering what you liked about it, and what were your favourite spots?
Well, one of the best eating experiences I ever had was in Florence at Enoteco Picchiori, which is the restaurant there. It's one of the, I think, yeah, there's probably two on my list of places that are just untouchable. That place
and McDonald's.
And what?
McDonald's.
And that was a place in teach me. I feel like a child in kindergarten.
You guys pulled this stuff up like that day you did the spell on me. I'm like watching. Like,
is he making this up? Oh no, it's.
Yeah, there was like, is that, no, he's doing the same thing over and over again.
But I remember the exorcism of Lisa, where she was, you know, possessed coming at me, and it was like two pages of Latin. That one, that was the most difficult one that I mean, because it's, you know, this is this, there's a reason that it's a dead language.
You know, what's interesting about things like that, I'll give you a real recent experience. I just did a feature film, I don't know if you know this, but you
can tell me this. Yes,
they're remaking Godzilla, and I have a little part in it.
Next door to us.
Yeah.
Next door to Supernatural.
And I don't know what was wrong with me that day, but I had one word, something like, blah, blah,
blah, technical jargon, blah, blah, blah. The graph is moving exponentially. And I said exponentially so many times that I started to go, I don't
understand what that word is.
I don't know what that word means anymore. And I don't know if I'm not saying it right. And then so I get halfway through exponentially. And I screwed this line up 20 times.
But see, it's a feature film. They've got the kind of money to work with that. Yeah. But way to go, buddy. We're going pro.
I know. I still wanted to crawl back in New York across the lawn. Remember you guys? You know, you made it over here, didn't you? By the end of it, I was going, you know what? I can play a good lizard. If you haven't filled that role yet, I could do the lizard part really well.
You know what? There was one in the episode, this is going way back, so episode Skin. There was I think Jared's told the story. Shapeshifter.
Yeah, it did.
Couldn't get it out. It was not coming out. I was mumbling. It was we basically like met in the alley. And it was like, okay, give the information very quickly so that we can go and take care of the situation. And
exponentially, like, is harder than shapeshifter.
That's true. But it was director was Robbie McGill. And he came up to me, he's like, you know, Jensen, the shapeshifter, you're kind of just swallowing the word. You just say it with a little bit more clarity. I was like, yeah, okay, that's fine. So I get in and I was like, sir, shapeshifter. I mean, totally. And then Jared just, boom. And now I can't say the line without stopping and literally straight face going, shapeshifter.
It gets in your head.
It does.
So all the whole time, all you're thinking about is, I'm getting to that word.
It's getting closer and closer and closer. Here it comes. Stop.
Sure.
And go. Yeah. So that one, that's it happens. It's like getting the giggles, you know, when people get tickled on set.
What's up, man?
Yeah.
That happens.
Man,
people get pissed off because I can't stop laughing because I love it.
Jared's notorious. I mean, we have to like stop production for half an hour. I'm gonna walk it off.
I want to be there for that.
Oh man,
and you'll be pissed at me because I won't help.
Yeah, you won't help the situation. I have done my coverage to a vibrating Jared's face. It's just like. I'm just stone-faced given my coverage because I know I don't have time to, like, you know, deal with his shenanigans. Sorry. Hi. Thank you. That's, you know, I'm sure there's many more stories, but I don't want to bore you guys. Hi.
Hi. My question for Jensen. Sorry.
You guys don't need to say that every time. You get really good with complex. You're going to give him a comment. Just ask the question and
you know what?
Figure it out.
I hate to break it to you. I've done 8 episodes. This man has done 8 seasons. Surprise, surprise, you have a few more questions for me.
What is your question?
I'd like to know how the character Dean influenced you as a person.
How does Dean influence Jensen? Well, he takes up a lot of my time. He just steals time. He is a needy little, it's interesting because over 8 years, you know, you grow up a lot as a person. We mature, we get older, you know, we attain more knowledge, we have life experiences that kind of shape who we are as human beings. One of my major life experiences has been playing this character for 8 years. So absolutely he is, you know, the experience of playing Dean has definitely given me an experience, a life experience that has helped shape who I am. What specifically that could be, I don't know specifics, but just a generalization, you know, I've spent 8 years with this, you know, with this character. And, you know, one of the reasons that I kind of grow my facial hair out and, you know, I actually, my hair was pretty long as of 2 days ago, and then I cut it again. But part of the reason I do that is so that I can see somebody different in the mirror. Because I literally, like, it's when I shave, I'm like, there's Dean Winchester. And so this kind of helps me shed that character for a few months out of the year. and kind of, you know, kind of purge myself. And then, you know, come July, I shave and my voice gets down to here. We go back at it. He's absolutely been a huge part of you know, the better part of a decade. So that's a lot. Yeah. Thank you.
Thank you.
Yeah. Good luck, Ty.
Please, this question is so below me. You know how I stay grounded? My bills, my mortgage, my divorce, my children, my life, my bad hair days.
Friends have a good day. Are you like me to have friends that are just completely unimpressed with what you do for a living?
Yes, absolutely.
Yeah. It's weird.
And my kids.
Not impressed. No. I wouldn't say completely unimpressed. I mean, I think they respect what I do, but it's funny. As I've gotten older, kind of the group of friends has kind of gotten smaller, and more concentrated. But those friends that I have kind of clung to over the past, 10 years, they don't treat me as a TV star or a celebrity they treat me like their buddy that they knew 10 years ago. And I think that having people in your life, family, that treat you the way that they always have and that never changed.
Mm-hmm. And again, I'm not, because I do the, you never said I've sat in on any of my panels, but I'll give the compliment to your face. You and Jared, that I always say is, the incredible thing about Jensen and Jared is that they haven't changed from season 2 at all. And I've made a living out of being a guest in other people's shows. I've done 150 different projects, so I'm an expert in this field of working on other people's shows. And I tell you how rare it is for two guys to stay as grounded as you two have been. So yes, I give you credit to your friends, but you made the choice to keep those friends around you, because a lot of people don't. Seriously.
Thanks, man.
Yeah, you made. Things and shoot somebody on the beach when they're 30 pounds overweight and show them this. Nobody wants to tell you the great things that people do, and I think you try to make a point of doing that, and so I sincerely mean that about these two gentlemen that work on this show. I've been doing this since 1997, and never had, I'll tell you my Jensen story. Don't let your head blow up, sir.
I'm not listening.
I've never had once star of a show come up to me and say, or first of all, the AD come up to me and say, Jensen wants to know if you want to shoot your stuff first or his stuff first. Never. Not once. 145 projects. I've never, ever had that. I literally was like, what? I'm ready to do it in any way you want. That's very nice. Half an hour later, Jensen comes over and goes, hey, dude, you want to run your lines? It's all my dialogue. The last thing he really wants to do is run fucking scene with me when he's got five lines in the scene. And that speaks of his character. It speaks of him as a leader on the show. And yes, I know you've got a lot of great friends around you, but you kept your friends around you. Because some people don't. So, thank you, buddy.
Thanks, man. Thank you. Hi.
Hi. My question is for Jensen.
I'm gonna go get us some beers.
Yeah. Okay. Thanks.
Shall I do that?
First off, I want to say you. I love you. You're really a great actor, and see you with my dream since 13 years.
Thank you.
I would like to know if you're not tired to play Dean Winchester since. 8 years.
So, what's the question? I didn't get it.
You're not tired to play Dean Winchester since 8 years.
Oh, am I tired of playing Dean Winchester?
Yes.
Okay. Why, do I look tired? Is it coming across that I'm just fed up with this guy and I just want to kick him to the curb? Because I don't. I am so thankful of this journey that I've gotten to go on these past 8 years, and look, there's a lot of great characters in film and in television and in stories out there. I think I got a pretty good one. I'm pretty happy about it. I still enjoy going to work after 170 plus episodes. So it's I'm not tired. Do I get tired of working? Yeah, I think everybody has their moments. You know, there's some days when it's, you know, in the middle of January and we have to be up at 6 a.m. and it's 22 degrees outside. That's Fahrenheit. I know you guys want the Celsius, but that's, what would that be? Like, it's cold, very cold. And the last thing you want to do is, you know, go put on your actor face and get in front of a camera that you know is going to be watched by millions of people. But that's when I pushed through, and I was like, you know what, this is one of the best jobs anybody could ever ask for, and I'm gonna do it, and I'm gonna love it, and I do. So, yeah, thank you.
You know why this show's been on 8 seasons? You guys. I mean, these guys are a fabulous show, but if you don't watch it, you don't support it, it doesn't exist. Lots of fabulous shows fall away. And so you guys, the fan base that the show has is putting on.
This is why this is so great. Ty's, this is what and a couple of these. And, you know, this is, it's such a unique opportunity to get to truly interact with the people that that support you, you know, that watch the show, and that really kind of go to bat for. I mean, you guys really kind of protect us too. I mean, you do. You save us from like a lot of the naysayers, and even though there might be a few here in the crowd. I'm kidding. But no, I mean, you really save us from the critics. You know, you save us from the people that are like, "What is the show? Why is it still on the air?" And a lot of times, you know, I've heard a lot of stories from you guys. I've been like, you know, that my friend didn't understand it, didn't know what the show was, and now it's like her favorite show on the air, and you know, blah blah blah. But it's it really is you guys that are the driving force behind what we do, and it's a great honor for us to get to come here and talk with you and answer your questions and just be around this kind of energy, because it's it helps us move forward and it keeps us excited about what we do. So thank you. Yeah. Yeah, you know, that song, it's a rather sad song, but it wasn't necessarily the meaning by the lyrics, that it was more the difficulty of the guitar playing. this is such a shallow answer. It was something that was very...
You want a shallow answer? I hate that you can play music and sing.
Shut up.
Guitar.
Shut up.
And act.
You love it. You love when I sing to you. When I would come home from a long day at work, up in Vancouver, and I come home to, to an empty apartment, and one of the things that I do to kind of unwind and relax is I just sit on the couch and pluck my guitar. I don't sing because I don't really care for the sound of my voice very much, but... So I literally just sit there and play the guitar, and that was a song that I learned. It was a really fun song for me to just play with, and it was very kind of therapeutic. And then I sang it one night for Steve, and he's like, "Oh well, we're gonna put that down. We're recording that for sure." And I, for some reason, let me let him talk me into it. So, you know, that's it was just something that helped me relax at night. Yeah. Thanks. Hi. What's that? I mean, I'm sure he would have instincts telling him what to do. Just as long
grab
as
the wheel and hit the gas.
Hey, there we go. Throw it in the drive and punch it.
Yeah, that came out wrong.
Sorry. It's a Sebastian moment for a moment. It's a good idea. Yeah. Thanks.
Thank you.
Yeah. Hi.
She's so bossy down there. Wanna see something? This is what I get to before the come on and get it anyways. Give me the Beckett.
What do you got? Did you draw this?
She made it for
me. Look at that.
I don't feel right if I don't break rules every half hour or so.
It's a drawing of me and my wife. Oh. Thank you. Yes.
I'm fired.
Was there a question?
So my question is for both of you.
Okay.
And what do you both have in common with your character?
We both look alike. That's the go-to question. Yeah, go-to answer there. I don't know. Ty?
Oh, this question always creeps me out. Because I have way more in common with it than I like it sometimes. you know, I think the overpowering thing about Benny is he exists in a world outside of what everybody else exists in. He doesn't belong. The vampires doesn't belong with the humans, and neither do I. I don't belong with the humans either. I've always felt I was born in the wrong time zone, at the time era. I'm a little out of place, a little out of time. People don't always get me.
I still don't get him.
Yeah. I'm confounded by things that people think are so important, and then other things mean. Yeah. So that's for me. That's the biggest thing is that I feel like I know exactly where that what it's like to be floating in a world that you don't quite belong in.
So I came in and did I think you will agree did a fantastic job, and I mean it wasn't like the character, you know, had to kind of develop. But he came in and was just like, boom, that's Benny, that makes sense. And we instantly, there was instant chemistry between the two characters, and that, of course, fueled multiple episodes. And, I not to brag too much about him, but it's, and I told the writers this, it's one of my favorite storylines to date is the Benny storyline. I just love the complexity of which it was, you know, and how it happened, what it did to the brothers' relationship, you know, how it really kind of, you know, contradicted everything Dean believed in, but at the same time, there was a friendship there that superseded, you know, what should have been done, and it was really easy when he came in because he nailed the character, he had it down from the get-go, and we immediately were just like, wow, this is a cool chemistry between two characters, and it's really fun when two actors, you know, who are relative strangers to each other, get on set and then just start flowing, and we really did. I mean, he and I just started. It was just like, you know, it was like
it's like
we know, like we work together for
and
years.
This is why you do it. This is why I do it. You know, like I'm very fortunate to work a lot. I stay busy, but. Not every project's got that feeling. Most projects don't. And I can remember being on, even being on the, you know, the Godzilla set, making a good living, doing what I love, having fun. Great, great people, great, you know, experience. But being longingly thinking, oh, okay, I'd like to go and do another Supernatural episode. Because it's just, you know, you get to click into something that feels so good and feels so right. It just feeds your soul. It just makes me feel so good to be able to do something I love. That role, writers.
It's a great role too. Yeah.
You guys. It's
yeah.
It's great.
Sorry, that really wasn't the question that you were asking, as far as, you know, what I have in common with Dean, you know, there's a lot that I have in common with Dean, there's a lot that I don't have in common with Dean. You know, I think he's, is that on a remote control? Please tell me that's on a remote control. Little closer. Yeah, give it a little. There you go. Justin. Hi. I feel like a little child. What the hell is going on right now?
I think it's really kind of mean not to give us the controls for that.
I think it's. Come here. Anyway, thanks for the question. That's one thing Dean and I have in common. Make a few steps.
Hi. Hi. Sorry, I'm going over this first mention. So I want to ask about Dean's phrase, that's amazing, son of a bitch. Just amazing. I love it.
What did you say his face?
His phrase.
What's phrase?
Phrase.
I think that particular phrase was something that came out of a performance choice that I gave in the pilot episode, in the very first episode of the series. It was on the bridge, in the car, and after I climb up out of the river covered in mud, and it wasn't written that I yelled it. It was just written that I say it under my breath. And I instead decided to yell it, and the writers really liked that, and I think that they kind of, Kripke was like, oh, that's a boom, there's a nice catchphrase for Dean. So, and then so a lot of that stuff just kind of happens organically. Like, I didn't intend it to be that, and I don't think Eric intended to write it as that, but then when we put the two, my performance and his writing together, some things really click, and that was one thing that did.
Okay,
thank you. Hi.
Hello. My question is for Jensen, but only because I just asked something.
Hey, that's fine. That's good. Cool. Would I be more of the eating pie and drinking beer if I knew that there was supernatural things out there? Or would I actually start hunting? Gosh, the pie and beer sounds really good.
Acting's a pretty cushy job sometimes, isn't it?
People ask me a lot of times, like, you know, what would you do, or have you ever had any supernatural encounters, you know, with ghosts or anything? And I like to say that, what my job has given me is the knowledge that I've gotten playing this character is enough to scare any actual ghost away from me, so I don't have to worry about it. Of course, which is probably a false sense of security, but I don't know. I think that if I had to hunt in real life, I'd take solace in the fact that I've had 8 years of practice.
My question for you is... Talking to each other on the phone every bastard! who makes the decision which color to wear that way? That was made of an Indian Russian at the end.
I know you're in line for me, right?
I have no idea.
You've got like the book. You've got like five things that I have to sign for you, don't I?
Yeah, right.
Yeah. I'm not signing your butt.
Once?
I'm not doing it because I know you'll get a tattoo.
They want us all to stay up here together for 5 minutes.
What?
Yeah.
I don't do that.
No. We don't work together.
I am standing down here the whole time.
So, Misha, I have a question for you.
What?
What do we do with this?
Is this the box that you opened?
No.
Isn't it obvious what you do with this?
Hello. I am the great wizard Ricardo.
Another fish.
Hello. I am the Indian Russian king.
I am the elderly old man who is confused.
And we are. Nobody important.
Speak for yourself.
This might be the worst skit ever done
or
performed on a stage. Shut your mouth when I'm talking.
The problem with these is you can't throw them at the audience without hurting the audience.
No, you can't. But, wow, this is, would anybody like this? Yes. Or no? Nobody wants this? Honestly, what are you going to do with this? I don't want to know. Never mind. That's. Alright, seriously. This is the great wizard Ricardo. Yeah? There you go. Knock yourself out.
You're going to have some good times. Will someone give this to Sebastian? Someone put this back in his arms and see him later. Well, she was like, I'm definitely going to see him later. Sweet, do you have his room number? I'm going to see him. Here you go. Can you give this to him? Thanks.
Wow, this whole panel just derailed.
Yeah, there is a part.
I mean, what a way to finish with a public show.
I have been as well behaved as I can be for as long as I can be.
Okay.
All right, I'm getting out of here. Misha Collins can take over. Guys, love you. Mean it. You guys are amazing.
Ty Olsson, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you, gentlemen. And we will see you later tomorrow. Maybe tonight. I don't know. So anyway.